Okay. This presentation is divided into two parts. Okay, so the second part will be presented by my colleague Tony Peña, that is sitting there. The second part is a demo on Arcuda, so it's the interesting part. But first, the boring part, I will present that boring part, that is the basis of Arcuda. I will explain what Arcuda is, so that when my colleague presents the demo, you already know what we are talking about. So, what's this talk about? I will talk about how to access, how to remotely access GPU computing resources from any node in a cluster. For so, the outline I will follow is first, I will introduce GPU computing, everybody knows about that, and then I will introduce some concerns that we can have related with GPU computing, and then the wish list. This is the list that everybody would like to have in the clusters. After that, I just will present Arcuda. I will introduce it, I will present how it works, and later I will introduce some performance numbers that we have measured. About GPU computing, everybody knows that GPUs are currently being used widely in almost every cluster. Many of the clusters in the top 500 lists are using GPUs, so everybody knows this. And also everybody knows the way GPUs are used. Basically, we have two different ways we can attach GPUs directly into the box in the nodes, or we could attach GPUs in a different box, like this one, and then using a cable for PCI Express, attaching that box to the main box. Anyway, this is not a networked box. This box can only, or the GPUs in this box can only be accessed from the cores inside the regular CPU box. At the end, what we have is just a set of nodes in the cluster, and the nodes may have one or more GPUs, and then the applications running in the cores in a given node will access the GPUs inside that node. How can we program GPUs? There have been many efforts, but basically today we can program them either using CUDA from NVIDIA or OpenCL. This is already well known. How should we program GPUs? We have two different stages here. We have the compilation stage and we have the execution stage. In the compilation stage, we take the program. The program will have code for the GPU and code for the CPU, and we separate those codes. And then when we execute the code, we start executing the code in the CPU, and then we transfer the kernels containing the GPU code to the GPU, and then we transfer the data. Once we transfer the data, we execute the kernel into the GPU, and then we transfer back the data from the GPU to the CPU. These transfers take time. So depending on the exact data we are transferring, we may have more or less overhead. In this case, I'm showing the overhead for a matrix-matrix multiplication. We can see that as the matrix size is larger, the overhead, the relative overhead, is smaller. We can see that for very small matrix sizes, the percentage of time devoted to data transfer is really high. So we should not use GPUs for this part or for these small matrix sizes. What can we find about GPU computing scenarios? Basically, what we should have clear is that not every program is suitable for being executed in a GPU. Even if we write the code for being executed, the code may not be performant. Only programs that present large data parallelism can be efficiently or can take advantage of the large engines, parallel engines that are inside a GPU. So we can find different scenarios. The first one is programs that present low level of data parallelism. Then in the opposite end, we have programs presenting a high level of data parallelism. And in between, we have a moderate level or another scenario where we may have applications that may use a tremendous amount of different GPUs. For the first two ones, the scenario where we have very low level of data parallelism, we don't need a GPU. We could use the CPU as always. For the other one, here we have a lot of computations that can be brought to the GPU. We just add one or more GPUs to every node in the cluster, and we are done. So that's easy. But what happens when we have a moderate level of data parallelism? In this case, this moderate level of data parallelism could be something between 40 and 80%. So this means that between 40 and 80%, the GPU will be used, but outside that percentage, the GPU will not be used. So what happens when the GPU is not being used? The GPU keeps consuming power, keeps wasting power in this case. So we should avoid this situation. For this kind of programs, the current scenario about having a lot of GPUs in a cluster may end having a lot of idle GPUs in the cluster, and this is an energy waste. And finally, for the multi-GPU computing scenario, what we have is an application. If we are able to design an application that is able to use 20, 40, 50 GPUs efficiently, we cannot provide that application this amount of GPUs, because currently a cluster, a node, can only have 4, 8 GPUs at most. So we will concentrate on these two scenarios, or CUDA is useful for these two scenarios. The first one, when we have a moderate level of data parallelism, and the second one, when we have an application that could use as many GPUs as available, but we can only provide that application a few GPUs. So this is our wish list. What is currently being done? Currently, we have this. We have a cluster with many CPU cores in every node, and one or more CPUs per node. Problems with this configuration that is currently deployed. The first problem is related with the moderate levels of data parallelism in applications. GPUs in the cluster may be idle for long periods of time. This costs money. The second concern is that in this scenario, an application running in this node can only use the GPUs attached to this node. It cannot use these old GPUs even if they are idle. We would like to provide all these GPUs to the application running in this node. How to solve these two concerns? The first one, the energy concern, could be as obvious as this. If we have a huge amount of GPUs and they remain idle, let's reduce the amount of GPUs so that they remain used all the time. How many GPUs do we need? It depends on the exact applications we are executing. For example, we could decide that we only need 20%, 25% of the GPUs, so we would remove 3 GPUs from each 4 boxes. So we would reduce a lot the initial expenses when buying this cluster, and we would reduce also the power consumption. Problem: this new configuration brings some scheduling problems. What happens, for example, if we have in this node all the cores running some application, but the GPU is idle because the scheduler that we have used for scheduling jobs in this cluster is not using this GPU because the application is not needing it. In this case, we have the CPUs used, we have the GPU free. The scheduler will not be able to dispatch to this node any job to use this GPU because there is no CPU available. Another possible problem is that if we have several GPUs per node, imagine that we have one GPU here being used and another one idle. And we have the same configuration here, one GPU being used and another one idle. Then we have an application that requires two GPUs. We have the two idle GPUs in the cluster, but that application cannot do that because the application will be run either here or here. But if it is run here, it will not be able to use this GPU. If it is run here, it's the same. It will not be able to access this GPU. So how can we address this new concern? What we can do is reducing the number of GPUs and this is the key question here, and sharing the remaining GPUs across the entire cluster. But sharing GPUs is hard, it's not done right now, except for Arcuda. If we are sharing GPUs, additionally, what we could do is addressing the multi-GPU computing scenario. We will be able to run an application in any of these nodes, and as the GPUs in the cluster are shared across the entire cluster, we will be able to provide the GPUs to that application. At the end, what we are doing is increasing GPU utilization, reducing costs, reducing energy consumption, etc., etc. How to share GPUs in the cluster? We can virtualize them. There are many solutions for virtualizing GPUs, but up to my knowledge, the only one that is really working with CUDA 4 support is Arcuda, which is the one I'm going to present. We can go further. In addition to virtualizing GPUs so that they are shared across the entire cluster, what we can do is enhancing the schedulers in the cluster so that whenever a GPU or a node is not used, we can switch it off. In this way, we would reduce the power consumption even more. Or, in a second step, what we could do is taking the GPUs off the boxes and attaching them, consolidating them in boxes with almost no CPU power, except for the CPU power required for controlling the GPUs, and then accessing the GPUs from the CPU boxes. In this way, providing different granularities to the scheduler, we would be able to switch off different amounts of GPUs. If, in addition, we allow for GPU transmigration, what we could do, what we will have, is true green GPU computing with real power reduction. At the end, what I'm proposing is disaggregating the GPUs from the CPUs and also, and later, enhancing the global schedulers to better use this new GPU configuration. So the rest of my talk before the tutorial on Arcuda is just presenting the way that we have this device to disaggregate GPUs from CPUs. And this is Arcuda. So from now on, all the talk will be presenting what Arcuda is and some results, some performance results for Arcuda. So what's Arcuda? Arcuda, after these introductions, is clear what it does. It's a framework, it's a middleware that enables running a CUDA-based application in one node, accessing the GPUs in a different node, seamlessly, without having to change virtually the application. As I have said, this will be useful when we have a moderate level of data parallelism or when we have applications that require an enormous amount of GPUs. If we have a huge amount of data parallelism, CUDA is not useful, because we already will be using 100% of the time the GPUs in the cluster. But for those cases where the GPUs may remain idle, Arcuda is useful. So these cases are these ones. We have a cluster. Initially, we have a cluster with a lot of idle GPUs because the applications are not taking advantage of them. And then what we propose with Arcuda is removing part of the GPUs, keeping only the ones that are really required, and then sharing the GPUs that we have kept in the cluster across all the nodes in the cluster. Later, my colleague will present some application running in this scenario. What we can also do with Arcuda is having all the GPUs in the cluster, putting them all together in a pool, like this, and then providing all those GPUs or part of those GPUs to some applications. This way we will be able to run an application in the CPUs in this node and accessing the GPUs across the network that are physically located in different nodes of the cluster. From a logical point of view, the application will notice or will think that the GPUs are attached to this node. My colleague will also present an execution of a program that will run in a single node and will be using GPUs from 6 different nodes, in total having 12 GPUs for the application. How does Arcuda work? Well, initially what we have when we don't have Arcuda, when we only have CUDA, is we have the CUDA application, and then the application will contact CUDA, the CUDA driver and runtime, which will contact the CUDA device. This is the current scenario. When we have Arcuda, we will have a client side and a server side. In the client side, we will run the application as always, and in the server side, we will have the CUDA device that will be accessed through the CUDA driver and runtime software provided by NVIDIA. What is missing here is the connection. What we will add is, in the client side, the RCUDA library that replaces the CUDA library. Everything is the same from the point of view of the application. The application will keep calling the CUDA functions, but now they are replaced by our library. And our RCUDA library will access through the network the RCUDA daemon that will be running in the server side. And once this RCUDA daemon receives requests from the application or from the RCUDA library, it will forward those requests to the real device. Basically, what we have is that the application is running a CUDA program, or is a CUDA program that will request CUDA services to the RCUDA library, and those requests will be forwarded through the network to the actual device. We will execute here the kernels with the data, and then the data, the result, will come back to the RCUDA library in the client side, which will be will deliver the results to the application. What we have in between is a communication protocol. Here we have the client, we have the RCUDA server here, and in between, every call to CUDA in the client will be intercepted by our software and will be forwarded to the server. And then the response will come back to the client that will forward the results or the result or the error code or whatever to the application. How compatible is RCUDA with RCUDA? Actually, if we want applications to use RCUDA without having to change anything, it should be 100% compatible. If not, we are failing. This way, here we present the different types of functions that CUDA presents, and you can see that for all the different types of functions, except for the ones that CUDA provides graphic functions, for the computing functions, we have provided full compatibility. 100% of the CUDA functions have been introduced in RCUDA. So in this way, any application could be run in our RCUDA framework. Here we can say the SDK samples from CUDA. In this case, the SDK samples are 80, and we have successfully implemented 56. What happened with the 24 remaining ones? In this case, these 24 samples either used the functions from the driver API. We are not providing support for the driver API. We are only providing support for the higher level. Or they are dealing with graphic functions that we are not supporting. Basically, what we are concerned about is with the GPU computing, not with graphical solutions. Next question. We have implemented most of the CUDA functions in RCUDA, and now the question is any program, any CUDA program, suitable or able to be run with RCUDA? So here, if I were a seller, I should say yes. But I'm a scientist, I'm a researcher, so I have to say no. We have some problems here. The problems we have here is that RCUDA doesn't support the CUDA CE extensions. NVIDIA, in order to make the code more readable and to help programmers in writing their code, they have provided the CUDA extensions, which actually is gluing some functions together in a few amount of lines. For example, here we have a short CUDA program. This call to CUDA, this other call to CUDA, and this call to CUDA, they belong to the plain C API, which is the one we have supported, but here we have the execution of a kernel that is written following the semantics of the CUDA extensions to C, and we are not supporting this. Actually, this can be translated into the plain C API with these changes. This is quite easy. The problem is twofold. First, when the NVIDIA compiler compiles this program, it will insert, when compiling this sentence, it will insert some undocumented functions into the code file. So As these are the undocumented functions, we cannot provide support for them. We should avoid this step. Avoiding this step is quite easy. We just, instead of using this kind of syntax, we can replace with these other sentences, which belong to the plain C API. Problem now, doing this for a long program is painful. You can do it quickly and easily for a short program, but if you have 300,000 lines in your code, as lamps, for example, you cannot do so manually. So in order to avoid this problem, we have developed a parser that will read all the source files and will translate all the CUDA C extensions and will extend these extensions to what we currently support. This parser, basically what will take is the CUDA program and will split the code in this program. The device code or the code to be executed in the GPU will be compiled by the NVIDIA compiler and will provide and will get the device code, and then with our converter we will get the host code. Our converter is based on the Clang framework, that is one of the LLVM projects. Does this conversion take more time? No. Basically, if we compare the time required for the original compilation with the NVIDIA compiler or the time required for the conversion and compilation with our tool, you can see that basically the time is the same. I have to say that in this case, in the LAMPS program, in order to translate from CUDA or convert from CUDA to RCUDA and extending the code, an expert took 2 weeks in doing such conversion. Our tool has taken less than 2 minutes. It's just compiling the program. Now, how well or how bad does RCUDA perform? We have 2 versions of RCUDA. The first version is based on TCP/IP. TCP/IP is available in any network, so this version can be widely used. Additionally, I have to say that this is a free version that you can download it from our webpage and you can try it if you are interested. And here, as we are using the TCP stack, we have to forward all the requests to the server, to the RCUDA server, through that stack, which is slow. So we will not have a really great performance. Actually, if we look at this plot, here we are multiplying a couple of matrices. We will see in green the time spent by a regular CPU to execute the matrix multiplication, and in yellow we can see that RCUDA takes almost the same time. This part of the time required by RCUDA is used in the actual execution of the kernel in the GPU, and all this time is because of the data transfers. This is because of the network. The network is 1 gig Ethernet, and we are using TCP/IP, and this is quite slow. But if we would use a beta network like InfiniBand, the numbers will be changed, as we are going to see now. We have a second version. This second version is based on InfiniBand. Obviously, InfiniBand is one of the best choices. Additionally, it's quite deployed, so making this version of RCUDA on InfiniBand is a way of ensuring that it will be useful for the community. And in this case, what we have used is the IB verse, the InfiniBand verse, in order to get more performance. The functionality is exactly the same. We are only changing the lower parts of RCUDA, the communication parts. And in this case, we are using GPU Direct, and we have developed a new communication engine that will use pipeline transfers in order to keep the engine communication and computing all the time. In this case, the numbers are completely different. If we multiply a couple of matrices again, here we have the bandwidth we are achieving for different cases. When we have the GPU inside of our node locally, the bandwidth of the PCI Express bus is really high. The bandwidth for RCUDA over gig Ethernet is really low. Everybody knows this. If we are using TCP/IP over InfiniBand, we will increase bandwidth a lot, but if we natively use InfiniBand with InfiniBand verbs, the bandwidth is close the bandwidth we are getting for our CUDA is really close to the maximum peak bandwidth of InfiniBand. In terms of time, we can see that if we make again the matrix-matrix product in a CPU, in a local GPU, or in a remote GPU using our CUDA, we can see that in blue, the time for the CPU is really high, but for CUDA and for our CUDA, the time is almost the same. Basically, we have reduced the overhead that the communications were giving us. If we look at the overhead, in blue, we have the overhead for the PCI Express bus when the GPU is local, and in red, we have the overhead for our CUDA. We can see that they are almost the same, and this is the percentage. We are quite lower than 100%, which is almost no overhead. If we execute a real application, well, matrix-matrix product is a nice application, but LAMPS, for example, is a much more complex application. In this case, if we execute LAMPS in 8 cores inside with using CPUs, no GPU here, we will have this time. If we use only one GPU using CUDA, we will reduce time by 24%. And if we use our CUDA and the only GPU is remotely accessed, we can see that we have almost no overhead, but we have a lot of flexibility. This is the performance and the functionality of our CUDA, and which is the current status. The current state of our CUDA is that we have almost finished the current version that is fully supporting CUDA 4.1. Once we are done with this version that is basically done, we will have the first component of the wish list I have presented. We will be able to efficiently virtualize GPUs in a cluster. And then the next step will be the scheduler. The next step will be integrating our CUDA into SLARM. That is one of the schedulers that is most widely used today. So at the end, once we are done with the two steps, we will be able to fulfill green GPU computing. And now, the practical part of this talk. My colleague will present the execution of several applications and how to compile, etc. In two notes we have there, I don't know if you have seen in the coffee breaks, a couple of notes we have in the room next to this one. And he will also connect to the CSCS notes in order to execute a more complex application.